All right. Let's see here. Let's fade that out a little bit, because first I want to introduce myself. I am the boss, Robert A. Tucker, and joining me tonight is my partner in crime, my cohort. He is the big ticket, Brandon Abels. What's up, Brandon?
What up, everybody? What up, boss? Nice to be here. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. For those that don't know who we are, let me provide a little bit bigger introduction. I have been the best professional wrestling manager in the Kentuckiana area for the last 2 years. I manage names like Vito Andretti, Big Ticket Brandon Abels right here, Nathan Steele, David Christopher, the Texas Outlaw, Thomas Mitchell, and various others. There's not very many managers in this area, so I can't say that I have much competition, but those that are trying to put up a fight ain't worth a shit compared to me. So, with that said, if you don't know the Big Ticket Brandon Abels, I'll let him explain who exactly he is.
Well, I am the biggest, baddest professional wrestler in the area today. There's nobody that even holds a candle to me. And as far as everybody else goes, anytime you want to step up, you know how to get a hold of me. I am the 7-foot-tall monster, and I will destroy anyone in my path, and that's a fact.
That's right. There's one guy that, you know, that you've challenged over and over and over again that hasn't stepped up to the plate. Rob Conway.
Rob Conway. Yeah, there was a particular night in Madison, Indiana, that I beat Rob Conway from pillar to post, all over the ring, all over the arena. Rob Conway rolls me up and hooks the tights and beats me 1-2-3, demands a rematch, and ever since then I haven't heard a hide or hair from him. He keeps hiding and ducking me every chance that he gets, and he only shows up where he knows I'm not.
Right, yeah. You know, he just showed up recently to that show they did in Versailles, Indiana, AWA Supreme, where they did that benefit show. He showed up to that, and it just happened that you weren't booked on the show.
Ain't that a coincidence? It's coincidence.
Yeah.
Purely coincidental.
Those joining us tonight, I want to thank you for joining us. You won't get thanks from me very often, but thank you. We are on the corner of Tucker Boulevard in the Tucker Estate, broadcasting live to all you fuckers. And you Tucker fuckers. We've got a ton to talk about tonight. We're going to do this every single Wednesday from 8 to 10 p.m. There's no holds barred. We're not going to hold back any punches. We are going to take care of business because, let's face it, ladies and gentlemen, business is good.
That's right.
So what are the topics on the agenda tonight? You know, we're going to probably talk a lot about pop culture, sports, politics, really whatever pops into our minds. You know, we don't really have anything that we're going to specifically stay on topic about. We may be all over the place as far as that goes.
Agenda free, baby.
That's right. So, you know, as far as topics goes, you know, we encourage you people to submit topics to us, submit questions to us. Let us know what you want to hear about. Let us know what you have questions about, any concerns. Hell, you can tell us if we suck. We don't care.
We will address that.
Yeah, exactly. We don't suck. We will address that right off the bat. We don't suck. We are the best faction along. Oh, I forgot to introduce, even though they aren't here tonight, although I hear that one of them will be calling in a little bit later. We'll have to see about that. They will be joining us periodically throughout a lot of these shows. A part of our group, he is a part of a tag team, and one other guy is Vicious Vito Andretti. He will be joining us hopefully tonight. If not tonight, various, you know, shows, throughout the time that we do this show, which I don't see it ending. So, ever, because we're awesome and, hell, we fit good together, so.
That's right.
We're like peas in a pod, baby.
Peanut butter and jelly.
Mm-hmm. And another one that will be joining us is Nate Steele. He'll be joining us. He is part of a tag team with Vito Andretti. And the newest member, hopefully if we can get him on, I don't know if he wants to do the show with us or not, but he is part of the Elite, and it is Lincoln, by God, Walker.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I've seen Lincoln Walker wrestle many, many times. Great talent. Great addition to Elite.
Yeah, and, you know, a lot of these guys that we've got in our group, you know, they have been around Kentuckiana. They have been around the United States. They have wrestled in front of 12,000-plus people. You know, Vito Andretti, Nate Steele, and Lincoln, by God, Walker, they were all trained by the best that this business has to offer in OVW here in Louisville. Mm-hmm. We are just outside of Louisville. We're in Clarksville, Indiana. But together, this area is called Kentuckiana. And, you know, we mainly stay on the Indiana side just because we want to. So
that and the Athletic Commission in Kentucky is some douchebags.
Yeah, they don't like us. Well, not necessarily me or you.
No.
Probably not Nate, but we won't go into details really much more about that. But, you know, they will be joining us periodically throughout the length of this show. And, you know, really what's on the agenda for tonight, let's just start off. This is more pop culture than, you know, anything. And it's not really, I guess you could say it's political. It's been in the news. What was the lady's name that had the terminally ill brain cancer, Brandon? What was her name again?
I believe it was Brittany Maynard.
Brittany Maynard. So here's the deal. Brittany Maynard has brain cancer that is inoperable. For those that have ever dealt with anything like that, you know, it's as time progresses, your body will just deteriorate and deteriorate and get worse and get worse and get worse. And here's my personal opinion on that. If, you know, if I am a consenting adult, if I have brain cancer, I know that I'm not going to get better. I know it's not going to be operated on. My body is just going to deteriorate. Instead of them trying to treat it, which obviously isn't going to work, so why would they fucking treat it anyway? They're not going to.
Right.
So without any hope, as my body deteriorates, I am a consenting adult. I should be able to say whether I want to live or not. And by that, I mean not go out and stick a gun to my head and blow my head off. But, I mean, as a consenting adult, if I believe that if you are able to, you know, go about your business and put a, instead of going through a slow death, the best way that I can say this is put an end to your life in a safe manner in your own home, you know, induce yourself, you know, not have, obviously, another, if you're consenting another doctor to do it, I'm perfectly fine with that. I don't know how Jack Kevorkian did it. I think there for a while, that's what he did. I think he was basically, he was a doctor at first that with the permission of his patients that were terminally ill, he gave them their wish and granted their wish and gave them a... gave them a painless death. And I think that eventually morphed into where he was just like, well, instead of getting their consent, I'm just going to kill
them. Yeah, and totally different there.
That is the difference. If as long as you are consenting for this to happen, I see no problem with it. And I think that with her, what happened is first she was going to end her life. She was going to go to Oregon and have this done. And then all of these religious fucks decided to get in on the matter and guilt trip her and judge her and make her life a living hell because she wanted to do this. And from my understanding, when it comes to religion, especially from a Christianity perspective, you're not supposed to judge. You're supposed to leave that to the higher being that you believe in.
Right. Ain't that like the number one rule besides treat others how you want to be treated is thou shalt not judge?
Yeah, that's like one of the number one things is thou shalt not judge. Oh, and I believe it was this guy named Jesus that said, take care of the sick, elderly, and the poor. I believe those are three things that he emphasized throughout the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
And these people just seem to fucking forget all that. They don't. They either A, they don't read the Bible, or they're two, they're fucking stupid.
No. The problem is that when Christians want to bring up an argument, they throw out all the Bible verses that go along with their argument, and they leave all the rest of the stuff out.
Yeah, they forget about everything else. Yeah. Oh, yeah, I see that totally.
Yeah, that's what it is. That's what it is. Well, this Bible verse, Corinthians 4, verse 7, goes along with my point, but I'm not going to look at Mark 3, verse 9, that says, I shouldn't be doing this.
Oh, and everything else that was in the Bible before the New Testament? Yeah, we'll just count that out, because that don't matter. God just changed his mind.
Right.
So he just changed his mind. None of that shit fucking matters. So just count that out. Pretend like it didn't exist. We're going to go by this now, and we're going to mark out this one verse because it doesn't fit with what I'm talking about here, and we're going to go with this because it proves my point.
Exactly.
So basically what happened was that she was guilt-tripped and judged into the point of where she broke down and decided she didn't want to do it. Now I guess that she is back to that point where she is wanting to do it again.
Actually, Rob, she's dead.
Is she dead?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, rest in peace. But anyway, so I guess that she finally did that then.
She did.
Okay, good. So word of advice, people, is that when somebody is going through that, why would you want to see any human being go through periods of suffering that is never ending for them?
Right.
The only end is death. So why would you want to see anybody go through something like that?
Miracles happen, Rob.
Miracles happen. Well, if miracles happened, they would, cure the fucking AIDS in Africa. They would, too, get rid of world hunger.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's like there's an average of like 1 in 5 children in the United States that go hungry.
Go to bed hungry. Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
That is an actual statistic.
So, if miracles happen, why the fuck is that still happening? So, I'm not a religious person, and, I'm not going to... The only people I do judge when it comes to this are the people that do the judging anyway.
Exactly.
So, you reap what you sow. So I tend to stick along the lines of is, don't force your shit on me, and I won't force my shit on you. I live by that mentality. You can believe whatever you want to believe in, but don't force it on me, because I'll state how I feel on it, and I don't care if you like it or not.
That's a good motto to live by. And see, the whole thing is I don't understand. I've watched people die of different kinds of cancer. It wasn't necessarily brain cancer. But why would you want to see... To me, it actually brings more closure to her family. She did this on her own recognizance, on her own free will. She didn't wither away to nothing, even though she was progressively getting sicker by the day. The day before she decided to actually end her life, she was having like 4 or 5 seizures a day. She wasn't recognizing her husband or her mother or anything of that nature. So why would you want that woman to go through that? That just makes no sense to
right.
me whatsoever. And instead of going through the chemotherapy and all that kind of deal, she went on like a bucket list kind of mission. She went and seen stuff that she wanted to see. She was not sick from the chemotherapy. And then the time come before she got too bad and her family had to see that she decided to end her life, which was going to end regardless.
Right. So, yeah, I don't, I'm along the same lines as you. I don't see anything wrong at all with these people, just doing what they need to do to make sure that they don't go through endless suffering.
Right.
And I'm along the same lines as that. And, as far as that shit goes, what I would recommend people to do is just not fucking judge.
Right.
If you are not in those shoes, just don't fucking judge it, because you have no idea what those people are going through.
Exactly.
If you can't fill their shoes for one day to feel what they're going through, then don't fucking judge.
Exactly.
That's the way I see it.
And it also, for the record, pisses me off that people call what she did suicide. The right. It's not suicide. Suicidal people want to die. This girl was 29 years old in the prime of her life, for all respects, healthy other than the brain cancer. She did not want to die. She was handed a terminal, terrible disease that she did not want to see through the end because it ends terribly, and she decided to die.
Well, even the people that, a lot of the people that commit suicide, you know, they, like, the people that are thinking about it will even tell you that they don't necessarily want to die. They don't want to die because, and the reason being, in they just, in their minds, they don't see any other way out of what they're in.
True,
that
true.
That is, you know, the only way that they see getting out of the suffering that they're in is to die. That, and it's not that they want to, it's just that they feel that they have to get away from what they're going through. It's like with the Robin Williams thing. Robin Williams was another guy, and, you know, this is, you know, this has probably been covered 1,000 times by 1,000,000 different people, but I feel that it kind of fits along the situation. Robin Williams was a guy that suffered from a depression his entire life. And those people that don't understand depression, that have never lived through it, just, it's one of those things. It is a disease. People don't understand that that is a disease that, you know, unless it's properly treated,
can control you.
It can control you and overtake your life, and many of the people that go through it end up not wanting to die, but that they see that's the only way out. And Robin Williams was also going through Parkinson's. He had all kinds of different problems. And in his mind, the only way out was death.
Right.
And people blasted him left and right and thought, oh, my God, he's a piece of shit. He committed suicide. It's like they're going to go out and burn his movies or something. I mean, it was just fucking ridiculous.
Well, I'm not going to do that because I happen to love the Night at Museum movies, and I will be in the theater when the third one is released.
Yep, and not in the Night at Museums. I loved a lot of Robin Williams movies, and, you know, a lot of people, some of these movies that people didn't necessarily care about, but I grew up on a lot of them. You know, people, a lot of people just, you know, got tired of Mrs. Doubtfire because it was on the TV all the time.
I actually watched that last night going to bed.
Yeah. I love Mrs. Doubtfire because I grew up on that shit. I grew up on a lot of shit that Robin Williams came out with. Hook. Hook's one of my favorite movies of all time.
What about Flubber?
Flubber I could do without.
Fucking Flubber.
I could do without Flubber, but, you know, Hook, even Bicentennial Man I liked. What Dreams May Come was kind of, it was okay. It wasn't my type of movie, but
Patch Adams
was a fantastic movie. You know, there are a ton of movies that Robin Williams came out with that, you know, without him, we would have never had or been able to see or been able to grow up on.
Right.
A lot of people don't understand it. And Robin Williams was a fantastic comedian, too.
Oh, yeah, for sure. It's just a shame he couldn't hang in there, right?
Right, exactly.
Oh, poor taste.
He got the hook too late.
Too soon, too soon.
Yeah, too soon, too late. Nobody will ever know. So... But as far as that goes, I think we're done talking about the death part anyway, but I figured that was probably an issue or a topic that needed to be discussed to some extent because on this network, for a lot of people that don't know, it's going to cover a lot of – people are going to have shows that are going to cover a lot of professional wrestling, but a lot of the times we don't get a lot of covering of pop culture and – happenings in the news and sports and that whole work. So we're going to try to cover that on here. We might mix a little bit of professional wrestling in, but we figure that with the lack of those other topics that we would fill in those lacking thereof.
Right. So Rob, in case there's people out there listening that want to get in and talk to us, how could they do so?
You can actually call in through Skype. There's two different ways to call in through Skype. You can call in the phone number. The phone number is 859-652-3922. Again, it's 859-652-3922. You can reach us through the phone number, or you can actually call us through Skype at Amped Radio. That's AMPD Radio. So... those are two different ways that you can call in. You can call in at any time. We'll take your calls at any time. and you can discuss the different topics that we're talking about. But if too many people call in at once, I'm sorry if you get dropped. Keep trying again.
Yeah, we'll talk to anybody. You know what? I want to bring up a sports topic that has a little local flavor, if you don't mind.
Sure.
I want to ask Kentucky Wildcats fans a question. Kentucky football obviously came off to a great start. 5-1 through the first six games of the season. Pretty much should have been 6-0 if it wasn't for the screw job that happened in the swamp in Gainesville, Florida. And then, suddenly, the University of Kentucky has become obsolete and the University of Kentucky of old. Here they are, two games remaining in the season. They need one win to be bowl eligible for the first time since, I think, 2008 or something along those lines. And they're playing Tennessee on the road this weekend. And then they come to Papa John's Cardinal Stadium to play the University of Louisville, which by all accounts is a loss for that football team. So my question to Kentucky fans is, would this be an absolute disastrous season for you if you were sitting at 5-1 with 4 or 5 to play, needing one win to become bowl eligible, and then you don't get in a bowl game? How would that make you feel as a Kentucky fan? And don't give me this shit, well, it's basketball season, because 2 weeks ago, y'all were all about football season, so don't give me a bunch of that crap either.
Well, you know, I mean, I'm not from this area, so I don't keep up with, I mean, I keep up with the local sports and everything, because obviously I see it all over Facebook, so
right.
I see people updating all the time, Kentucky won, Louisville won. Kentucky sucks, Louisville sucks. You know, I see all that going through Facebook all the damn time. I see all of the memes going through there with Calipari getting bent over and spanked, or, you know, whatever. Or the Cardinal giving the dick to the cat.
Right, right. That's one of my personal favorites, actually.
Yeah, I see that all the time. You know, I don't keep up with it like a lot of people would, and maybe there's people that can call in and chime in on that. If you can, phone number is 859-652-3922. Also on Skype at Amped Radio, AMPDRADIO.
You know what your problem is with college sports is you've never had a college sports team to root for. Outside of Cincinnati having King and Martin, and then when Brian Kelly was there and going 12-0 with Pike as their quarterback, you haven't had much to cheer about for college athletics.
No, not really. And, you know, I cheered for the Cats when that went on, but I haven't kept up with them at all. I don't know if they're ever going to do anything again in college football.
Well, for the record, next time you say Cats, can we please add Bearcats in front of that?
Oh, yeah, Bearcats. Yeah. Sorry.
Yeah.
And who knows? I mean, the problem is that when I was in high school, the Cincinnati Bearcats had probably, for the longest time, had one of the best college basketball teams in the nation. They did.
They was close. They
was
up
with Bob Huggins. They had the best college basketball team with Kenyon Martin and a few other guys that were on that team. They were just dominant year in and year out. And yeah, they were a bunch of fucking thugs and all kinds of shit. But at the same time, who else are you going to get to come to Cincinnati when Cincinnati University of Cincinnati is in the fucking hood of Cincinnati?
Right, right.
So I mean, there's not going to be your top tier college basketball players, your McDonald's All Americans. They're going to come to Cincinnati to play and worry about getting fucking raped in downtown fucking Cincinnati. It's just not going to happen.
Well, for the record, Mick Cronin is not a bad coach, but the problem that Cincinnati has now is that they're on the outside looking in of the Power Five conferences. They're stuck in the American Athletic Conference, and they're not going to get no love from college football, whether they have a good team or not. College basketball is a whole other story. I haven't really seen what they're ranked what their rank is preseason, but they'll probably be up there again. They'll definitely be competing for the AAC championship.
Yeah, I just, you know, I don't know if from a football perspective, even or a basketball perspective, if they'll ever be as dominant as they were in the late 90s, early 2000s. Football, it was a little bit later, but
right.
Basketball, I don't know if they'll ever get back to that point, because both programs now. And it's partially because of the athletic director and shit that's there that fired Bob Huggins and all kinds of shit. it's now viewed as a stepping stone for coaches.
Right.
You know, they go to Cincinnati, they improve the program, and these bigger colleges look at them and say, hey, these guys are legit, let's bring them into the program, a la Brian Kelly.
Oh, yeah, good one. And But you know what? Cronin's been up there, what, 5 years or so, and he ain't went nowhere.
No, he ain't went nowhere because he hasn't done shit. I mean, he's got them into the tournament, but has he got – I mean, he hasn't even got past first round, has he?
That I don't know. I know they had a pretty damn good team a couple of years ago when they played Louisville in the final Big East championship game at Madison Square Garden the year that Louisville went to the Final Four and played Kentucky. I know that they – were in the title game against Cincinnati, and that was the toughest league in college basketball at that point. So, I mean, he had to be doing something right.
Right, right. And this goes to all – I mean, the only other athletic programs I even remotely follow are Michigan teams.
What the hell is your problem?
I don't – I mean, the only reason I keep up with them is because they're one of the – they're two of the only teams that fucking ESPN will fucking cover from any – college perspective. It seems like it's the Michigan teams, Ohio State, Notre Dame, and that's about fucking it.
Well, the Big Ten is terrible. Let's just get that out of the way now. And then Michigan, they've got that big controversy with their coach letting that kid play earlier in the year that sustained a concussion. Michigan is on the hot seat, and they're going to be looking for them a new football coach here real soon.
Right. And see, that's the thing. I mean, the guy that they brought in, what's his name up there in Michigan?
I think it's Dumbass. I'm not exactly sure.
Dumbass.
Yeah.
They brought him in. Brady Hoke.
That's who it is.
They brought him in with the aspect that he was going to turn around the program. And there, for about the first year or two, he did. He turned it around. They were doing fucking great. And then this year, they started losing to, like, all these fucking lower-end schools and shit, and then they finally started to pick it up. They won against Penn State and some other colleges and shit. But
Penn State, get out of here.
But the only reason I keep up with Michigan is because every time I turn Michigan or Michigan State is because every time that I turn it on ESPN, they're either covering the basketball teams or the football teams for them, and that's the only reason I know a little bit about them, and plus I've got a lot of friends that live in Michigan, so... You know, I keep up with from that perspective and stuff, but...
Now, Michigan basketball is, in fact, back. That's who the University of Louisville beat in the 2000 national title game. They made another run to the Elite Eight. Probably got a good team coming back this year. I don't know too much about them, but they're probably there. Michigan State basketball always there.
Right, right. You know, and, yeah, Michigan State with Izzo is always there. So,
oh, always.
Always. You don't have to worry about that. And I follow the Hoosiers a little bit, but, I mean, ever since Crean has taken over.
They're too busy over each other up there.
Ever since that they've gotten – they had a really good team, what, 2 years ago?
2 years ago, and they crapped out in the Sweet 16.
They had a fucking fantastic team. They should have been in the Final Four.
Yeah, well, they should have.
And like I said, ever since that Bob Knight has gotten fired from there, that team has not been as dominant and shit as they – well, I guess Mike Davis did take them to the championship game that one year.
Oh, good.
But that was
Mike
Bob
Davis
that was
is terrible.
But that was Bob Knight's team.
Yeah, yeah, it was. And then you had that Samson guy, but he was too busy cheating every time he turned around.
Right.
He was trying to text players and stuff when he wasn't supposed to. That guy was a joke.
Isn't he in the NBA now or something?
Probably. That's where all the convicts go.
Yeah, he's not allowed in the NCAA anymore, so he went to the NBA.
yeah, he did that crap twice. He did it when he was at Oklahoma, and then he came up to Indiana and did it.
Who does that sound like?
Some guy that's had every Final Four vacated. God, what is his name? I just haven't heard of him in the last 10 seconds. Calipari, that's it.
Yeah.
By the way, I will be buying tickets to Vacate 8 when they lower that banner from Rupp Arena. I think it will be the greatest thing on the planet, and I will be laughing in my wife's face.
Yeah, I don't, you know, I during the March Madness of this last year, I made a video on YouTube where I said that I'm not from this area. So quit fucking telling me about Louisville and Kentucky in the, what was it, the Final Four?
No, that year they got to the Sweet 16 last year.
Oh, okay. Where they were playing each other or whatever?
Yeah, they were playing. They were playing in the Sweet 16.
I heard so much about all this shit talk on Facebook and all this stuff. So I made a YouTube video. It was just like, leave me the fuck out of it. I don't care. Like, I don't care. If one way or another, if Louisville or Kentucky wins or loses or whatever, I don't care. It's not going to matter to me one way or another. I mean, I enjoy a good basketball game every now and then, but, you know, I mean, I'm just not from this area, so I can't get excited about it like some people do.
Oh, no. In this area, it is a way of life, my man. It is Louisville versus Kentucky, and when it happens, like it's going to on November the 29th at Papa John's Cardinal Stadium, shit is going to hit the proverbial fan.
Yeah. I remember working downtown when I worked on 4th Street. And when they were in the Sweet 16, they were playing Kentucky. I was there downtown. And this wasn't this last year. This was the year before.
Then it would have been 2012 in the Final Four.
Yeah, it would have been in the Final Four then. So I remember being downtown, and the place was so packed because they were trying to watch it on these little fucking monitors at the bars. All these people were watching at these little monitors at the bars. I mean, they were out in the street. The street was packed. And every time a shot was made, I mean, it just erupted. Erupted. I mean, I couldn't believe it because, you know, obviously I'm not from this area, so I don't know. I didn't know how popular it was because I had just moved down here.
Right.
And I didn't know how popular it was, but I had trouble getting out of downtown Louisville.
Oh, yeah, brother. It's a way of life.
I couldn't even get out of the damn place. I waited an hour to get out of Louisville.
Yep.
So, it is popular down here, but the shit talk on Facebook or wherever, leave me the fuck out of it because, like I said, I don't care.
I can't help it. I partake in it.
I know you do.
I hate the University of Kentucky. I'll just say that now.
You've become more tolerable since you got married.
Not really. I just do it so I don't have to sleep outside with the dog.
Well, as far as sports goes and everything, you know, I'm a Cincinnati Reds fan. So I'm...
I'm sorry. I just find that humorous. Go ahead.
You know, this year was a huge... I mean, not to say that the last few years haven't been a disappointment, but compared to this year,
Bro.
You know, I would take in the last few years over this year.
Bro, how do you have some of the best players in the National League, some of the best pitching in the National League, and then you can't even get to the postseason, and then when you do get there, you get bowed out in the first round?
That's the Reds.
That's Cincinnati Reds baseball, baby.
I don't know what else to say about it. We've come accustomed to that. I mean, and I don't know if it's due to recent ownership or whatever the fuck it's due to, but, you know, ever since, you know, Marge shot when she stopped being the owner of the team, it's been downhill. Because Marge Schott wasn't afraid to spend money.
Right.
Marge Schott went out and got fucking players. And, I mean, at one point, they were the second highest paid team. Not the second highest. Well, I guess second highest payroll in the National, and not in the National League, but in the major leagues next to the Yankees 1 year.
Well, that's pretty impressive.
So they had the second highest payroll. And that year, they went to the NLCS. So, I mean, if you do spend money in Major League Baseball, odds are that you're probably going to do it. Now, this was before. This was before Sabermetrics, you know, the Moneyball. So this was before Moneyball, when they took into the aspect of all these different metrics and everything to look at. When comparing how good of a player somebody is to being an overpaid fucking player.
Right, right.
So, you know, now it's a little bit more fair because you've got a lot of these teams that aren't paid near as much that
like
are going
farther. Like the Kansas City Royals?
Exactly, or the Oakland Athletics.
Right.
Obviously, if you've ever watched Moneyball, there you go. But you've got a lot of these teams that don't have a very high payroll, but they have great teams, and it's because they're looking at statistics to determine what is a good player and what is not. And obviously, there's a lot of overpaid players still in the major league. So, but I guess that would probably go for just about any you know professional sport, but Major League Baseball in particular, because you know, some of these guys, Jesus fucking Christ, getting paid $30 million fucking year to play fucking baseball.
Right.
I mean, I love baseball, don't get me wrong, but Jesus, I would take $500,000. You know what I mean? I mean, fucking, and that's the league minimum, like $500,000.
Oh, yeah, I'll ride the pine for $500,000.
Exactly. I'll do that any day. You know, be able to travel all around the United States and play a fucking kids game.
Right.
You know?
And if you're one of the guys making league minimum, chances are you're not even playing. You're just sitting there just watching the game.
Right, right. So, my Cincinnati Reds this year were a huge fucking disappointment compared to the last few years, and they decided that they wanted to get rid of their third base coach, which is a good decision because he fucking blew, and replaced them with the old Nationals manager, Jim Riggleman, who coached the Louisville Bats down here. So I think that that's a good move because you got a guy that is a former major league manager. He knows what the hell he's doing. He was successful in the for the Nationals. He had a good fucking team. He just basically quit because there was some sort of contract dispute going on. I don't know what was going on, but he was just like, you know what, I've had enough of this shit. I'm done. So he went and he started coaching the Louisville Bats. He got on with the Reds, started coaching the Louisville Bats. I think it's a good move. Johnny Cueto finished second in the NL for Cy Young. Billy Hamilton finished second in the NL for Rookie of the Year. So they had some good players. They just couldn't fucking win anything.
They always do. They got Votto, Bruce Phillips, those guys just mentioned. Chapman coming in as a closer, throwing over 100 almost every time he winds back and throws the ball.
Oh, yeah. Well, the problem was is Votto was hurt again this year. So he was out at least two-thirds of the season. And then Bruce had the worst year of his professional career this year. He'd been lucky to bat .220.
Really?
He was fucking awful this year. He was terrible. And then they don't have anybody to play left field, so they platooned people in left field. They had Chris Heisey and Ryan Ludwig, which they batted a combined maybe .230. They were fucking terrible, too.
Wow.
Their pitching was phenomenal, as it always is. Their pitching was phenomenal, but if you don't score runs, you can't fucking win.
Right.
So, you know, I'm hoping this next year will be better. I'm hoping that they go out and get some bats that can fucking hit the ball and put them in left field. You know, we've needed a right-handed power bat for fucking ever, and we've never gotten it. We got Johnny Gomes. He did good 1 year. He hit 20-some bombs and drove in like 90 runs and batted like .260 or .270. He did good, and then the next year he was nothing. And then we got Ryan Ludwig. He did good 1 year, and he did about the same. He hit like 25 or 26 bombs and batted and drove in like almost 90 runs, and then nothing. And he was awful.
I say bring back steroids. Baseball was so much more fun to watch when the steroids were involved.
Well, and that's, you know what? I think that when you look at a lot of the pitchers that have went into the Hall of Fame recently, like Tom Glavine and Greg Maddux,
right?
And you look at them and how well that they pitched during that era.
It's pretty impressive.
It's fucking impressive because, I mean, those guys pitched so well during that era when these guys were hitting 60, 70 bombs on a regular basis, and they were still able to pitch as good as they did.
Right, right.
It's just unfucking believable what they did. I was glad to see Frank Thomas go into Hall of Fame. He was one of my favorite players.
The Big Hurt.
The Big Hurt. One of my favorite players of all time. So I was glad to see him go in, and I was glad to see Maddux go in because he pitched for so long and was so effective and didn't have the best stuff. Like, he didn't throw hard, but he could hit. Basically, if you held a dime up behind home plate, he could hit that dime. I mean, that's how effective he was when it came to pitching, how much control he had.
Control is important.
And Tom Glavine, I don't know how he pitched as well as he did, but he did. And I've watched him pitch I don't know how many times, but he would throw chest high and still get by with shit. I mean, where these guys' powerhouses were, he would get by with shit. He was just, I guess, that deceptive. So I don't... You know, I was glad to see those guys go in. They definitely deserved it. Will we see another 300-game winner again? I don't know. Will we see a 3,000-strikeout guy again? I don't know. I think we'll see. And honestly, the way it's going, I mean, people are leading the league in home runs with 40 home runs.
Right.
Are we going to see another 500 home run guy again?
No, probably not.
I'm skeptical of all that shit, you know?
But those pitching stats you just mentioned, that guy for the San Francisco Giants, Mason Bumgarner, that guy is for real, man. He's a good pitcher.
Which is funny because he did so well this year, but when they faced the Reds in the playoffs, he got fucking shelled. He got shelled against the Reds.
Yeah, that's kind of weird.
But, you know, I guess, you know, 2 years does make a difference. So, you know, I was glad to see that they did well. I think it's time for somebody else to win next year, though.
Yeah, I was rooting for the Royals. I was too.
I was rooting for the Royals because, you know, the last time that they were in the playoffs was like in the mid-80s with George Brett.
Right, it was 29 years.
Yeah, so, you know, Reds were... Well, I think that they were in the playoffs, but I don't think that they'd ever been to the World Series.
Oh, like, was it the World Series that they kept like saying 80s, over and over again?
It was mid-80s or something. I can't remember. But it was like the Reds. The Reds had not been to the playoffs since, like, 95 when they finally went back a couple years ago. And they had not been to the World Series since 90, so...
Right.
You know, I'm crossing my fingers and... my toes and hoping one day that they finally fucking get back.
Hey, bro, at least you're not Vito Andretti and,
yeah. Oh, by the way, I just watched, have you seen Back to the Future 2?
Maybe when I was like 10.
I watched Back to the Future. Adrian had never seen any of the Back to the Futures at all, period. Never seen them.
And isn't she our age?
She's 25.
Oh.
So she had never seen them, and... we watched one the other day, and then we finally watched episode 2 last night. In episode 2, it was 2015, and the Cubs had beat Miami in the World Series.
Now,
in 2015.
Now, if that happens this coming season, would you shit on yourself?
I would. I might. I would.
If Michael J. Fox predicted the future in the, what was it, late 80s, early 90s?
It was like 87, something like that.
Oh, wow.
87 to 89. Well, no, 89 was the third, so I'm thinking like 87 was...
That, and they were actually called Miami?
They were called Miami, but see, Miami would have had to have been in the American League.
Oh, that's right.
So they can't, obviously they can't play each other in the World Series. But if the Cubs win the World Series in 2015.
And go through the Marlins?
And go through the Marlins, fuck.
Do you know what? The Cubs-Marlins should be like one of the biggest rivalries in baseball.
Uh-huh.
It was the Marlins that cost the Cubs, along with Bartman, the World Series in, 2004?
Yep. I don't know the next time the Marlins are going to get there. They're just, their ownership's fucking terrible. They have no idea what they're doing down there. I don't know. And they're their best player. I don't even know if he's going to stay. Stanton. I don't even know if he's going to stay there. The Cubs, on the other hand, have the best farm system in the major leagues.
That's what everybody says. And, you know, that was the Reds' key to success a couple years ago.
Yep.
They completely drained Louisville of all their good players, and they produced on a major league level, and it was pretty impressive to watch. Now, if Chicago can do the same thing, I'll be really impressed. But, by the way, Chicago is pissing me off. As somebody that really enjoys history and loves sports, and as somebody that just went through Fenway Park a month ago, Chicago and what they're doing to Wrigley Field is pissing me off beyond all belief of what they're doing.
Tearing down all that shit?
Yes, it is. Here's something that really bothers me. Fenway Park is the oldest major league ballpark that there is. It was built in, this was their 104th season or something like that.
Yeah.
And they really haven't renovated that place in years. It's not really up to date. They still have a manual scoreboard, the whole nine yards.
Right.
And then free agents say that they won't go to Chicago because it's old and outdated, but all free agents want to go to Boston.
Right, which makes no sense at all.
Riddle me that, Batman. I just don't get it.
Well, I mean, I will say that they have done a better job at restoring Fenway Park than they have Chicago. But it's mainly because that they put all new shit up in Boston. They right. put, you know, the walls and stuff they replace because they're not made out of fucking brick.
Right.
You know what I mean? So, I mean, it's a little bit different situation there. So.
Yeah, I got to admit, if I'm chasing a fly ball in right field and a brick wall is coming towards me, I'm pretty much going to slow up. I'm not crashing into a brick wall night
right.
after night after night.
Right. No. No, that ain't going to happen. So, yeah, as far as baseball goes, you know I'm a baseball guy. I follow the Bengals and shit in the NFL, which...
We can get to the Bengals after our first break.
Yeah, we need to take a break here soon. So I'm going to... Let me put together some music here. We'll just go ahead and throw that in there. And, oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, baby. That's how we like it.
Okay, so we're going to go to a break here. We're going to play about 3 songs or so. And then once we come back, we'll talk a little bit more about maybe some sports, some more news headlines. Then we'll probably cover some professional wrestling.
Oh, boy.
Mainly local. We'll stick to local.
I'll stick to local?
We've got a lot to say about local. We got a lot to say.
Oh, boy. I can't wait.
Yep, exactly. So, we are going to go to a break here. We'll be back here in about 15 minutes or so. Stick around and be sure to, ask any questions or whatever. Send us some messages on Facebook.
Twitter. Hit me up on Twitter. At B-Ables, A-B-L-E-S, 5034 on Twitter. Hit me up. We'll answer any questions that you guys have. Professional
yep.
wrestling, sports.
Yep. And on Twitter as well, for me, it's Amped TV Radio. It's AMPD TV Radio. All one word there. Hit me up on Twitter. You can hit me up on Facebook. I'm not going to give you my real name, but if you're on my Facebook, you know who I am. So anyway, we're going to go ahead here and go to break. We'll be back in about 15 minutes.
Beer 30, baby.
All right. We are back. We are back.
And better than ever.
Yep, we've got another hour of talk here going on, and we've got all kinds of shit that we want to talk about.
That's right.
Really, anything that pops off the top of our head, we're going to talk about. But we're talking about pop culture. We're talking about the news. We're talking about sports. And we're even going to throw in a little bit about our good old Indiana and Kentucky professional wrestling. We might talk about... something caught in my throat there, and no, it was not a cock.
Are you okay, Tyler? You need the Heineken, or are you
woo!
Good?
I think it was a chip.
I am a train limo driver. I mean, what?
Nah.
And Rob, let's not mention anybody by name, because they might get a little butt hurt.
Well,
we know, good God knows, that people post on Facebook about their lead all the time being assholes. So,
well, yeah, and then people don't want to work with us because...
Oh, God. We're Jesus. Just terrible individuals.
Yeah, we're just fucking terrible.
Just because we're better than everybody else and we tell it the way it fucking is.
That's right. Well, I don't know if there's anything really else in the news that's been there lately that we really need to talk about.
I'm going to guess some people got shot. Some people got killed.
Some shit was stolen.
Yeah, some stuff was probably stolen. Oh, yeah, the subway was held up, and there was a high-speed police chase over by my crib.
Oh, sweet.
But I will not disclose where I live, because I make a lot of people angry in the ring, so we'll just skim right over that.
Yeah. We're not going to give out where we live or anything. We'll just say that... We're on the corner of Tucker Avenue in the Tucker Estate here, and yes, there is a road by me called Tucker Avenue, and it was named after me. So,
you're a famous son of a bitch.
I am a famous son of a bitch, and the people around here love me so much that they named a road after me.
That's just the way it goes for you Ohioans.
That's right.
Is it Ohioans? Oh, a hand?
We are Buckeyes.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
That's what we are. We're Buckeyes.
That is the dumbest mascot in NCAA, by the way.
I know. I don't follow Ohio State. I never have. Jesus. I've always been a Cincinnati guy.
The most overrated college sports teams in the history of the world is the Ohio State Buckeyes.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe next week.
Yep. And so as far as the news goes, I think we've covered that, pop culture. I'm not really sure. If there's been any news with that. Oh, didn't you say Chelsea Handler has been showing her tits and ass all over freaking Twitter and stuff lately?
Chelsea Handler, TNA. And it's the real TNA, TNA that I actually want to watch.
Right.
Or see. But, yeah, evidently Chelsea Handler, a few weeks ago was the first one on Twitter, was mocking Vladimir Putin and showed herself topless riding a horse.
Mm-hmm.
And then earlier today or yesterday, one or the other, she decided to mock a Kim Kardashian magazine cover, I think it was, and took a picture of herself bare-ass in her bathroom mirror.
Cool. You know, and for how old is Chelsea Handler? Is she in her 40s?
I can goggle that. Hold on a second.
Goggle?
Yeah, that's what I call it.
The goggle. I think if she's in her 40s, she is a good-looking 40-year-old.
She is smoking hot. I'm not going to lie to you.
Well, she's a good-looking one.
And I can say smoking hot right now about another woman because my wife is at work.
And so is my girlfriend. So
hell to the yeah.
But, no, Chelsea Handler showing her breasticles over the twatter. And, what else we got going on? I'm just not sure if there's anything else. Oh, the fappening. You heard about the fappening, didn't you?
Did fat people finally have enough and storm McDonald's for more Big Macs?
No.
Oh, so you're not saying fattening.
No, not the fattening. The fattening is when Cousin Kurt goes to McDonald's and orders all the Big Macs.
Shout out to Cousin Kurt.
To Cousin Kurt. Love you, buddy. No, the fappening. The fappening is what happened when a hacker hacked a whole bunch of celebrity women's cell phones.
Yeah,
and got a whole bunch of nudies on there. We're talking about,
J-Law.
J-Law, we're talking about, Kim Kardashian has another sex tape out.
Oh, my God. Who cares? Explain to me why she's famous. I know her dad was an O.J. lawyer.
She is the most talentless hack I've ever seen. And her whole family's life. Well, I will take that back. At least Chloe was on American Idol. At least she did something. You know what I mean? At least she was a host of American Idol.
Get out of it. American Idol hasn't been relevant in 5 years.
Well, I mean, it's more than what the rest of them can fucking say. What else have they done? They haven't done shit besides Kim got naked and fucked somebody on video.
Fucked Ray J, right?
Right.
That was, yeah.
And who the fuck is Ray J? Brandy's fucking brother? I mean,
I think he's literally a C-list rapper.
Yeah. I mean, what the fuck?
But by the way, according to Goggle and Wikipedia, and we all know Wikipedia does not lie.
No.
Chelsea Handler is approaching her 40th birthday in February.
Oh, so she's really not that old. She's good looking. I I'd bang her.
Yeah.
Anyway, so the fappening, we had Jennifer Lawrence, we had Kim Kardashian, we had Nicki Minaj, we had, who else did we have? A whole bunch of, like, people I've never fucking heard of. Some Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders.
What's it? Ain't Nicki Minaj kind of in pop culture news because people are accusing her of having butt implants? Is that true, or is that just fake Facebook?
I know that her and Iggy Azalea has, like, some sort of feud going on, too.
Iggy, who?
You don't know who Iggy is? Is that a fancy song?
Isn't heard Iggy a term in wrestling?
Yeah.
That Jack and Vito like to use a lot?
Yeah.
She
is a female rapper that... She did some modeling and shit, too. I don't know what else she's done. But she has a couple songs out. One called Black Widow and another one called Fancy, which...
I'm sorry, the only Fancy that I care about is... Here's your one chance, Fancy, don't let me down.
They've got some sort of feud going on. I don't know what the fuck it's all about, but that's been in the news within the last 3-4 months, something like that. I don't know who else was in the fappening. I can't remember off the top of my head. There was a lot of people a lot of the Disney and Nickelodeon celebrities like Victoria Justice and what's her name? She sings a lot now.
I don't know, dude. I'm 30 years old.
Oh. I try to keep up with this shit, but like... you know, I don't get to see the news that often. I don't watch the local news because it's all the same shit every fucking night anyway.
That and Rick Van Hoos has got to be the most terrible news anchor I've ever seen in my life.
It's just every night it's somebody got killed, somebody got shot, something was
stolen. And why is it in the city of Louisville nobody ever deserves to be murdered? You always hear family members, he was such a good boy, he was turning his life around, and then and this person had a mile sheet a mile and a half long.
Yeah. And then I just want somebody to get on the news when somebody dies and say, yeah, he deserved it. He was a piece of shit.
Right.
I just want somebody to say that one fucking time.
This motherfucker was dealing meth on the weekends, and this motherfucker finally got killed.
Oh, he deserved it. I hated that motherfucker. I want to hear somebody get on the news and say that.
And neighbors are always shocked. Be like, yeah. Dude, he beat the shit out of his wife for 3 consecutive years.
I mean, and, you know, it's like, I want to get somebody on the news to say that because it's always doom and gloom all the fucking time. At least throw some fucking humor in there or something.
Right, right.
It's all
doom and
gloom.
Fuck the right in the pussy. There you go.
It's doom and gloom, or it's people crying because they got money to help repair their house, or, you know, there's all kinds of, it's all fucking negative shit. There's nothing ever positive about the news, so why the fuck should I watch it?
I
would just rather not watch it and just find out from somebody else, oh, did you hear this on the news? No, I didn't. Sorry, I didn't hear it.
Yeah, right.
But it's like that everywhere, man. It's like that in Cincinnati, too. It's the same shit.
Was the fappening where the fake AJ Lee and fake Velvet Sky...
You know what? I don't think that was a fake Velvet Sky. I think that was her. I really do. There was Melina. Melina was on there, too.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Melina was on there, too.
Did, like, every WWE member plow through her while she was on the roster?
Basically, and she is the... I mean... Her and Batista and, you know, whoever else she fucked is the reason that John Morrison was, you know. Misused.
Yeah,
that's it. And eventually he just left. Because apparently, from what I understand, from what I was told, that Vince McMahon didn't think very highly of him because he didn't stick up for himself and shit.
Makes sense.
At least stick up for yourself. If you get your ass beat, you get your ass beat. You know, right. I'm not afraid. I'm the type of person that, you know, I may get my ass beat, but I'm not going to be afraid to fight you.
Right.
I mean, I may get my ass beat, and, you know, but I'm not going to be afraid to fucking stick up for myself and fight. So, you know, there's just some people that are pussies and just back down at any given chance. But, you know.
Yeah. And then there's some people like, to run around and start rumors and all that kind of deal, too.
Yeah.
Speaking of Southern Indiana wrestling.
Yeah, well, you know, I'm sure that that's like that everywhere as far as professional wrestling goes. We just don't hear about it enough or see it. But in Southern Indiana, when it comes to professional wrestling, there's too many fucking promotions. There is, in Clarksville, there's like 4 promotions. In Clarksville alone. There's
more than that, right?
There's
IWA.
IWA, there's Furious Wrestling Society, there's UWA, there's EPW, and they're all running out of the same venue.
And who's that other promotion that runs at Jammers? They've ran once at Jammers.
I know who you're talking about, but they are booked by the same people. They're booked by...
all of them, but UWA is booked by the same people.
Yeah, they're all booked by the same people except for the UWA.
All use the same people.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing fresh, nothing exciting.
No, why would you... I just don't understand it. Just call it one fucking promotion and you use the people and you hold more shows.
Well,
what the fuck is wrong with these people? Like, I don't get it. One, I'm owed money by some of them, along with many of countless other fucking people.
Right.
And two, I don't get why you run a promotion and you can't pay your fucking people. If you can't pay your people, you cannot run a business, and a promotion is a business. So what the fuck are you doing? Like...
It's called fan is backing them that has money.
Come join the free carnival? I mean, what the fuck? I don't get it. So, Q-Ball, which is another guy that does a show on my network, he covered sort of the same shit that's going up in Michigan that we were talking about here. If you run a promotion and you can't pay your people, just hang up the boots. It's over with. It's done. Don't fucking take the time out of the day of these people that they could be going elsewhere and earning money to help put food on the table for their families and better their wrestling career.
There are some promotions in this area that could pay people that just don't.
Right. Well, that's just fucking greed.
Right. But you know what?
It gets their jollies off somehow. I don't get it.
I get it. But you know what? If you don't want to pay your undercard guys, that's fine. But the people that draw money for you, that pay the $6 to $10 to come see XYZ wrestler, pay those guys. Because those are the guys that are putting money into your promotion.
Right.
And know how to use your people, too. If you're a booker and you don't know how to use a specific person, tell them. Because they might have an idea, too.
Right. Right. That's all I hear about how, you know, and it's harder for a wrestling manager than it is for a wrestler. Because a lot of promotions don't want to use a manager. They don't want to use
Which is idiotic.
Which is idiotic because, one, even if the person can talk, even if the wrestler can talk, you can still put a manager with them to help draw more heat.
Exactly.
That's the point. A lot of these places, one, they don't understand the concept of a manager. Two, they don't want to book them. And three, they don't want to pay them anything either.
Well, you know what I find funny is that some promotions around here and promoters and bookers and yada, 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 they want to call themselves an old-school wrestling fan, and we do things the old-school way. Well, guess what? Managers were a staple in the old-school days.
Right.
Lou Albano, Bobby Heenan, Harvey Whippleman, the list goes on and on
Jimmy
and
Hart.
On. Jim, the Mouth of the South. The list goes on and on and on, but they call themselves an old-school wrestling guy. But don't want to use a manager. Get out of here.
They're only old school. It's remember when we were talking about religion earlier? It's like, well, we can mark out this point in the history's past of professional wrestling. But as long as we have this, then that makes me old school.
Right.
You know, it's not, they don't stick to all the aspects that, you know, Memphis wrestling and all that stuff that brought professional wrestling into what it is today. You watch WWE, that shit's not professional wrestling.
No.
I mean, it's pure fucking entertainment and Hollywood glamour and spectacle. That's
and maybe,
all it is.
Maybe we should lay it out for maybe somebody that's not so much, we'll say a casual wrestling fan, and somebody that is too young to remember good wrestling. There is a major, major difference between professional wrestling and sports entertainment. The WWE is sports entertainment. Professional wrestling is the USWA, CWA, AWA, and the list goes on and on. That is professional wrestling.
Right, and a lot of people don't understand that. But, you know, when, back to getting on the manager aspect, you know, I've dealt with, you know, being a professional wrestling manager myself, it's hard to get booked.
Right.
I mean, I can go out and get you guys booked, but are they going to book me to go along with you guys? Now, if you guys say, hey, we're bringing him along, whether you like it or not, then that's going to get booked. Now, whether they pay me or not is a different story because a lot of these places don't want to pay managers. And even then, you know, some of the more successful ones in this area have came out and said that they don't want to pay managers. Why? I don't know. I don't get that. I don't understand that. If you're a part of the show and you help draw heat and you help draw money
right.
to that angle, to that feud, you should get paid. I mean, it's that simple. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. You know, I don't understand the aspect. And you know, Kenny Boland made a very good point to me not too long ago. He said that your show is only as good as the talent that you pay for.
Exactly.
So if you don't pay for talent at all, your show is going to be shit. Because those are the guys that are going to come to the shows. And that one, they don't give a shit whether they're paid or not, so how could they give a shit about your promotion or give a shit about what they're doing out there in the ring or give a shit about the person that they're out there wrestling to make sure that they don't get fucking hurt?
Or understand their spot on the card.
Or understand their spot on the card. Everybody wants to be a main fucking inventor when you're not.
Just a little word of advice. If you're a curtain jerk match, you don't have to get a bunch of high-flying spots in.
No.
It don't need to be done.
No, and honestly, you know, when you're in a curtain jerk match, when you're opening the show, you're setting the pace for the entire show. So if you come out there high-flying and doing all these fucking flips and everything like that, the fans are going to be bored with the rest of the fucking show.
Right.
So you need to set the pace for the show. As the show goes on, it gets better.
Exactly.
You don't go out there and blow them away with the first fucking match, and then they expect that to be that way or better the entire match. It's just not going to... The show's going to be shit. People are going to be bored, and guess what's going to happen? They're not going to come back the next time.
Oh, well, are you saying that that's happened in places that we've been?
Yeah, well, yeah, we've seen that.
Oh.
When you're drawing fucking flies... When you can't draw flies to fucking shit, then... You know, to a pile of shit, then, you know, you need to take a look at what's going on. Now you need to reevaluate what is fucking going on.
Let me ask you something, Rob. Let's track down memory lane a little bit here. And this kind of ties into the whole manager thing. Let's for a second say that the boss, Robert A. Tucker, was not an integral part of the Dirty South Players versus the Fat and the Furious for 6 months last year, that all culminated one glorious night in Madison, Indiana. Would that feud have had as much steam as it did?
I don't think it would have.
I don't either.
I don't, because there were a lot of turns. There were a lot of additions to that feud that made it better. As far as guys we added to the Dirty South Players. And the matches and the stuff that you guys had from that point, because of the distractions from the ringside from me, whether it be with the referee or, you know, the Fat and the Furious, it added to the entire program. People don't seem to understand that. When you have a manager, it adds to the entire program because, one, a manager is not a wrestler.
Right.
A manager is not a wrestler. So, therefore, you know, he is not going to be able to get in the ring and go with these guys, and he is going to be protected the entire time by the people that he's managing. So, by the end of the feud that's going on, there's a payoff. And the payoff is that they finally get their hand on
the ass beat.
Exactly. Nobody understands this. Even the people that book managers nowadays, they don't fucking get it. You know, I mean, I implore people to get on YouTube. Get on YouTube. It is an excellent source for professional wrestling. Get on there and look at some of these interviews with people like Jerry Lawler, with people like...
Hogan. You know how glorious it was when you were a kid that Hogan finally got his hands on Bobby the Brain Heenan? Do you remember that stuff?
Exactly. Well, even Bobby the Brain, you know. Bobby the Brain is probably my idol when it comes to wrestling managers. There's nobody better than Bobby the Brain, although I will say a close second would be Cornette to me as far as his promo ability.
Oh, yeah.
I look at Bobby the Brain Heenan because his antics and his inspiration, his antics and his ability to just come up with something quirky on a whim. I mean, he could just, with the snap of a finger, think of something that would throw people entirely off.
Right.
And Cornette was more good at coming out with a fierce, like a, just a, best thing I can say is a heated promo.
Oh, my God.
He was so good with coming off with puns and everything, just on a whim and able to come up with a promo. And you knew he meant business.
Yeah, Cornette looked like he was going to have a heart attack every time
exactly,
he cut one.
Exactly. You knew he meant business. So I look at those two guys. They were two totally different managers, in my opinion. They were able to do different things. And I take things from either one of those and apply it to what I do.
Right.
You know, I look at other guys, too. I mean, I look at Jimmy Hart. Mainly when he was in Memphis, and when he went up north, he was just fucking, there was nothing good about it. I look at him, and I look at Father James Mitchell, because a lot of people don't understand, the stuff that James Mitchell does, nobody else can do. Nobody else can do the dark manager stuff that James Mitchell does.
Paul came close.
Well, Paul Bearer, obviously, but James Mitchell does more of a sinister type of, and they called him, that's why they called him the Sinister Minister at one point.
Well, there you go.
But he does a really sinister, dark manager. Paul Bearer was more of just an overall dark manager, but I even liked him when he was Percy Pringle.
So oh, yeah.
I watched him when he was Percy Pringle, and he was just as good as doing that as he was Paul Bearer. So he just never got as much attention with that.
Right.
But people just don't understand. These promoters don't understand that there is a payoff when it comes to managers.
That's because promoters don't understand storytelling. And what we had last year with the Dirty South players and the Fat and the Furious was storytelling 101. Mm-hmm. Those people came week after week after week after week to see us fight each other, and that's what it was. It was not a wrestling match. It was a fight. Those people were emotionally invested. Those people wanted to see the Dirty South players get their ass whooped on a nightly basis. They wanted to see you get your revenge on me. They wanted to see all kinds of stuff.
Right.
And they eventually got it. Not the way that they wanted, but they got their payoff.
Right. And I think that was, you know, I think that the way that was went down is because we had a little bit of a free reign there for a while to do the stuff that we needed to do.
Very little while.
And then once that got fizzled out because people got pissed that we were getting, let's be honest, people got jealous. They got jealous because they were in the main event. One, we were never in the main event.
No,
ever.
Never.
We were always like second to third from the end
of the
show.
I think the best we got was semi-main couple times.
And we were the ones that the people were there to see. We were the most. Once we were done, it pretty much killed the rest of the night.
The place emptied.
The place emptied.
On more than one occasion.
More than one occasion.
We would be sitting in the back watching the monitors, and you would see people literally leaving, and they would not come back.
Right, and we would regularly have, on a daily basis, there 90 to 150 people.
Oh, yeah.
That was there for about 6 months. That is what they had.
Yep.
It was 90 to 150 people. And as soon as they quit with that feud, as soon as that was over with, it plummeted. They're lucky to get right now, and I'm not going to name any promotions. I'm not going to name any names, but they're lucky to get 20 people. Lucky. I've seen the shows.
20 people, 4 paid.
Yeah, 4 paid. The rest are family members that get in free. And they've got to have some money marks going on there because I don't understand how they're staying in business at all, how they're getting that rent paid. I don't get it. They've got to have money marks. They've got to.
I don't know.
And then they started to get a church involved with it, and everything got watered down. And now it's just a glorified fucking carnival.
I won't say nothing bad about the
people.
It's
not glorified. I'd actually go to a carnival.
Right. Well, I won't say nothing bad about the people because I like a lot of the people up there still. But the fact of the matter is that they had a mountain, literally a mountain of money last year in a feud that, you know what? A feud is supposed to end as a steel cage match. And our feud only got stronger. And then, you know, there was never anything necessarily that the Dirty South players were going for other than to shut you up as the commissioner and to beat the hell out of Vito Andretti and Jack Black. But you know what? People rallied behind you. People rallied behind Jack and Vito, and they were, like I said earlier, they were emotionally involved, and they hated us to the point that as soon as our music queued up, that place went apeshit crazy.
Yeah,
booing and cussing. People did not realize that the money that they had there.
No, they didn't.
They were too worried about other things and other quote-unquote programs on the show to realize what they had. And when we tried to tell them what they had, they didn't want to listen to us.
No, they didn't want to listen to us. And every time that I made a suggestion, it was turned down. Every fucking time.
Oh, yeah.
I think I might have gotten one thing done. But it was after one thing that I got to do that I liked, but it was after that whole feud.
Right.
It was when you were leaving the Dirty South players.
Right.
Was when we finally got to do something that we wanted to do, and the people went apeshit nuts for that.
And then I literally got hurt, and things have been downhill.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, the thing about that feud is that first I was a babyface.
Right.
You know, first...
Which, you are not a believable baby, by the way.
No, I'm not. I was a baby face, and they did love me, and they wanted to see me beat the shit out of you guys, but they knew I probably couldn't. So they knew that.
How many times did I chokeslam you during that whole thing?
Oh,
three?
My God, at least three times. I was in matches with you guys. I got my ass beat. But the least thing they expected out of all that was me actually turning around to be the backer of you guys.
Right.
When that happened,
that was a poetic justice.
I mean, everybody just went quiet. I mean, there was just like nobody was talking.
You know what?
Fucking believe.
Most people would think quiet was bad, but on that particular occasion, I think it was actually a very, very good thing.
Yeah. It was like when we debuted as the Elite. Debuted as the Elite. It was silence.
Right.
I mean, there was nobody talking. There was nobody booing. There was not. They just could not believe
that us four were together.
Yeah, that all four of us were together. They could not fucking believe it. And
but all you got to do is pay attention.
Yeah, and with the Dirty South players is when you finally added me to the mix of being the backers of you guys, and then we finally added Nate.
Oh yeah.
And then shit started to take off. Because then we had a good faction. We had four or five people in the group against two.
Right.
And, you know, that culminated into where you guys were supposed to have that strap match that one night.
Yeah.
And there were probably 75, 80 people there that night, I would imagine. Maybe 90. And it was like a live TV crowd. That's how loud it was.
Oh, are you talking about the night that Tom Mitchell joined the Dirty South Players Club?
Oh, my God. It was so loud that night.
You would have thought those 80 people were 2,500 people.
Yeah. Oh, God. They hated us with a passion after that. My God. You would have thought that we kicked their dogs and pissed on their grandmother's graves and all kinds of shit. They hated us.
Oh, yeah.
They hated us. And apparently, nobody ever saw that. Nobody noticed that in the back, except for us. Apparently, nobody noticed that. I mean, there were a few that were like, oh, my God, I couldn't believe that you... But the people that ran the show, apparently, their matches at the end of the night where they hit each other with microwaves and shit mattered. People were into that.
You know what? We have video evidence that says that crowd went crazy.
It's actually on my Facebook page.
Oh, yeah. Robert A. Tucker on Facebook.
Robert A. Tucker on Facebook. It's on our Facebook page. If you don't believe us, go ahead and watch that. If you don't believe that adding a manager affects anything, I want you to also take a look at the benefit show that I did in Seymour, Indiana, where I was managing Thomas Mitchell, and we gave a pre-match promo against the guy that organized the event. If you don't believe that a manager can get somebody over instantly and make a match better and more and just overall generally be followed more than any other regular match, watch that. I'm not saying I'm the best at being a manager, because I'm not. Obviously, there's been tons more that are way better than me, but... I can't hold a candle to a lot of the legends and stuff. I mean, there's just no comparison. But I'm just using it as an example to explain what a manager can add to even just a one match. It doesn't have to be an entire feud, just one match. If there's any promoters listening to this, go watch it. I mean, you know, I just don't understand why these days that they're not utilizing managers. I don't get it.
Well, even...
I mean, and also, everything's got to be fucking corny. I mean, we can cover that, too. Everything's got to be...
Comedy.
Yeah. That same show, they would have 2, 3, 4 spots of matches that were comedy. They'd have at least 2, 3, or 4 matches that were nothing but comedy.
Bad, not
even good comedy. I mean, I'm talking bad comedy. I'd be throwing eggs and fucking tomatoes at these people. I don't get it. There is a spot for comedy on a show, but it's one fucking match. It's in the middle of the show. It's not in the main event when Sorry. AWA Supreme. We're not going to name names, but we'll name promotions. When the AWA Supreme Championship is on the line, you don't do fucking comedy. You don't do it. It takes away from the fucking championship. It makes people think, well, this shit doesn't mean anything. This title doesn't mean anything. You know, people can't take it seriously. If they can't take something seriously, how are they ever supposed to take your promotion seriously? How are they ever supposed to take that feud seriously? How are they ever supposed to take you seriously?
Right.
So, I mean, it's just non-fucking-stop at that place. Non-stop comedy. Been brought to their attention by multiple different people plenty of fucking times, and they just don't get it. They don't get it. They don't get it, and there's no point in telling them again because they're still doing this shit. I mean, they were just featured on freaking World's Famous Flea Market.
Yeah, but that wasn't because of the comedy.
No, that
was intentional comedy.
It wasn't intentional comedy, but still. That is because of people that are in the ring that don't belong in the fucking ring.
I will say this. Managers are integral for a wrestler that can't talk.
Right.
And no disrespect to the Outlaw, Thomas Mitchell. I like the guy. He's great. I've had many pretty good matches with Tom. But Tom couldn't talk.
Nope.
And when he got put with you as a heel, Tom's stock went through the roof. Through
right.
the roof.
Right. People started taking him more seriously. They hated him a hell of a lot more if he was just a heel by himself. And as soon as he was put with me, he was put in the world title picture.
Right.
Because instantly he became noticeable. He became important to the whole picture.
And I will say, along those lines, congratulations to the Texas Outlaw on his recent world title win.
Yep, congrats, buddy. Sorry about your World Famous Flea Market video.
Right, and it was way overdue, Tom, way overdue.
Yeah. I'm sure that he'll probably be listening to this to some extent. I always had fun managing Tom. It was easy, we got over way more than I thought we would.
He rocked my jaw one night. Oof, that discus punch ain't no joke.
I mean, when we took you out with that chair, remember that?
Yeah, you asshole. That's what hurt me. That's why I had to go to a doctor to MRIs and stuff.
That wasn't me who hit you with it. It was Tom.
Yeah. He's kind of vicious. And, he laid me out with that chair. What was it, 17 times y'all hit me with that chair?
Oh, I actually hit you with the chair, but I think it was Tom's hit that put you in the hospital.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
I hit you pretty damn hard.
And by the way, that is for real. I literally had to go to an orthopedic surgeon and thought I was having to have another knee surgery. That is fact.
Yeah, and I think that was Tom who did that to you.
Yeah.
But
that's
smarter. Nonetheless, if we take a look at that, if we take a look at what happened there, the people absolutely fucking hated us that night. Oh, my God.
How do I go from the most hated guy
so
to the promotion to the most loved in the matter of 5 minutes?
But they were so worried about you.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they were like, oh, my God.
Do you know how many Facebook messages I got laying in the hospital? Do you understand? I went from in 5 minute span to the most hated guy on the promotion that people threatened to stab at one point in my career to a guy that they were willing to follow me to the hospital. That's crazy.
But that's what a manager can do for a face.
Right. And that's what an actual bad guy taking his job seriously can do, too.
Right.
Because you two beat the piss out of me. My whole upper leg and knee was bruised for 2 weeks.
Yep. And I mean, you know, and that's the thing. Like, the people don't understand, like, the promoters don't understand that what a manager can add to a heel wrestler, he adds even more to the babyface.
Do you know how big
a heel is what draws the fans?
Right.
People don't understand. They don't understand that either. They think the babyface is
no.
People, and they also don't understand. John Cena does draw as a babyface, hear me out.
I've got a counterpoint. Go ahead.
Hear me out. John Cena draws to the extent of he sells merchandise and
to kids,
but he still sells it.
Oh, good.
But he also does a lot of fucking PR. He gets his face out there. He is in the news constantly. He is in the, you know, TMZ. He's in all this stuff. He's on that the Total Divas bullshit. He's in everything.
Dude.
So I will give John Cena as a babyface an extent that he does draw some on his own, but the people that he's facing as a heel that they want to see, that the kids want to see him beat the shit out of, are really what draws.
Right.
Right.
And when's the last time Cena, besides Brock Lesnar, had a credible heel to go up against that people actually thought that John Cena was going to lose to?
Right. I think it was probably Triple H.
Maybe.
But maybe Triple H. There hasn't been anybody else.
Maybe there the Rock, during the Nexus.
Would The Rock have done? I mean, they're kind of both baby things.
The Rock. Cena was a heel on that program.
Well, yeah, obviously.
Maybe Barrett during the whole Nexus thing? Maybe?
I don't know. Well, Punk. Punk was a heel, basically. Yeah. So there you go.
Punk.
So when Punk was
Which,
heel,
by the way, that son of a bitch is not coming back. Quit it with the CM Punk chance.
Yeah, he's not coming back. If he comes back, it'll be for a one-shot deal and he'll be gone again.
Yep. He'll make his money.
He's made his money. He's done. I'm sorry. I mean, you never say never, but...
I do.
I don't see it coming back anytime soon.
You'll never see Steve Austin back in a WWE ring wrestling a match, and you'll never see CM Punk in a WWE ring wrestling another match unless they give him creative control over what he's doing like they do with Jericho.
Right. Well, his biggest thing is I think Punk doesn't like the PG shit. I think that's why he's gone. I don't think he likes the PG shit. He doesn't like how
I think
Cena is constantly fucking featured and shit.
Exactly. You know what? There's other guys in that promotion that can actually wrestle and work a match that's not WWE style, that can get over with the crowd by themselves, and Punk was fed up with it. Punk is a guy no different than me and you. He came up through the indie ranks. He was wrestling in front of five people at one point in his career. Cena wasn't.
Yeah, Cena, he got trained in California, and then he came to OVW because basically of his build.
Oh, yeah.
That's the reason.
And his athletic background.
I will give Cena credit. When he was in OVW, he could work a fucking match.
You know what? Call Kenny Bowen. I want to see what Kenny Bowen has to say about Cena.
I'm not going to call Kenny right
Come now. On.
No, Kenny will say the same thing I was, is that you watch the heel Cena in
heel
OVW.
Cena in OVW was awesome.
Was awesome. He could fucking work. And he just, the promos were so much fucking better. You know, all this corny shit that he fucking does now. His promos were so much better. A lot of people don't realize the stuff that he did in OVW.
No.
Because I just never got a chance to watch it. I implore you, there's actually a couple videos on our YouTube page of Cena in OVW, one facing Nova for the OVW championship.
Loved Nova in OVW.
One facing Nova, and then I think there's another one where he interrupts an interview and cuts a promo, and there's a couple other things on there. Oh, where he meets him and Kenny Bolin meet Mark Cuban, which is fantastic.
Yeah, I forgot about all that.
So I would watch. Watch his heel stuff from OVW. A lot of people don't realize what he is capable of actually doing as a heel. He's never going to turn heel in WWE.
No,
because
he does turn heel, the grown-ups will cheer him, and the kids will boo him. So who cares at that point?
Right. So it's not going to happen, but enough with the WWE shit. TNA is not worth fucking talking about.
Who's that?
Yeah, it's not worth fucking talking about.
I don't even know who their world champion is right now.
But I do want to talk about something, and we've got about another 15 minutes here before we go off the air, but I want to cover something here that just recently was announced by Global Force Wrestling. That good old JR...
Coming back, baby.
...is coming back to do the New Japan Global Force Wrestling joint show in Japan.
From the Tokyo Dome.
From the Tokyo Dome, which is expected, by the way, to draw over 40,000 people.
Jesus Christ.
Yep. So, I'm excited to see that. That is actually, I've never been much into Japanese wrestling.
Me neither.
I've never been into the Lucha shit. But I tell you,
Lucha's dumb.
I'll tell you what, man. If JR is involved in a wrestling show, he adds a whole nother level.
Cred. He adds credibility.
I mean,
straight out
the way
game.
That he can call a match absolutely adds. He adds value to any wrestling program he's on.
Everything's going to be a slobber knocker, bro.
Yeah. But he does. I mean, he's the best there. I mean, let's face it. JR is the best announcer there ever was. I think he I don't think anybody has called more high-profile matches, has made more recognizable calls
maybe
than
it's
JR.
Maybe it's just me and Channel 3 Wrestling, as everybody affectionately calls it.
Well, you like Ward Solley?
No, I love Lance Russell and Dave Brown.
Well, I love Lance Russell and Dave Brown, too, but I don't think that they...
But you're right. As far as iconic voices go, it's definitely Jim Ross.
So, I mean, he adds a whole new level to the show. And honestly, this is another thing that a lot of local promotions don't understand. If you're going to have a wrestling show and you want to be taken seriously and you want to look like you're legit, you've got YouTube. Utilize it.
Right.
Tape your shows and add commentary. It's not that fucking hard. It's not expensive to do.
Commentary goes a long way.
It's not that expensive to do. Add commentary. Get people that can call a match. Not get people to just fucking joke around on there. You don't need two Jerry Lawlers.
No.
You don't need two Jim Rosses. But you can have a Jerry Lawler and a Jim Ross.
A Jerry Ross.
A Jerry Ross.
As you were going to say.
As I was going to say. If you have a combination of both, it adds a whole new level to your show. But again, people, they don't.
The thing is with these local indie federations, and I'm not bashing any of you guys. I don't want you to take that the wrong way. You guys book me, and I appreciate every booking. But that being said, a lot of indie wrestlers in this area could not tell a story in a ring if their life depended on it. And if you're going to have a television show or a YouTube show or what have you, and your wrestlers can't tell a story, guess what you got to have to tell your story that you want to get across?
You got
commentators.
You got your commentators. And even so, I mean, they should be able to tell a story in the ring. If they don't have any fucking chemistry or psychology, then what the fuck?
Psychology.
Yeah.
Wait, what? Wait a minute. So I shouldn't go for an arm wringer 15 minutes into a match?
Yeah.
What?
We're 6 minutes in. Rest break.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, well, you know, we gotta do a sleeper hold. We got to do an arm wringer, you know.
Cardio goes a long way.
Yeah. You know, if you cannot tell a story in the ring, you either need to go back to training or you need to fucking learn.
And doing
that means you need to go back to training, probably.
35 high spots in a match does not mean that you're telling a story.
No. I'm tired of the spot fests. You know,
yep.
We don't need 500 flippy dudes and kicky dudes.
And along those same lines, hardcore wrestling, not telling any kind of fucking story other than they're idiots.
No, hardcore. The problem with hardcore wrestling is that, and Jim Cornette puts this out very well. He explains it very well. The problem with it is you're going to have to constantly outdo the last match that you have.
What is it you say about death matches?
If somebody doesn't die, what's the fucking point?
Right.
I mean, what is the fucking point in having a death match if nobody dies? I mean, fucking kill somebody. At least, hey, you know what? Somebody's walking. It's just so fucking stupid. You know, might as well just have a whole fucking show of Viagra on a pole match.
But I participated in the King of Death Tournament 2014, and I had 85 stitches. That's storytelling, bro.
Yeah, you had 85 stitches. You know what? What talent does it fucking take to walk up and hit somebody with a ball bat?
None.
No, because anybody can fucking do that.
And it takes very little intelligence to let somebody do that to you.
Yeah, what talent does it take to go up and staple something to somebody's head? It takes no fucking talent at all. Anybody can fucking do that. But on the other hand, if you're having a wrestling match that involves two athletes or two people that are able to tell a story in the ring, that are able to go toe-to-toe and entertain the fans
and beat the shit out of each other,
athletic competition and beat the shit out of each other, that takes talent.
Yes, it does.
Beating each other senseless with fucking weapons and all kinds of shit, it doesn't take any talent at all.
And jumping off 20-foot roofs.
Well, we'll probably get people that'll message us and say, oh, hardcore wrestler, you don't know if it takes talent or not. No, I did this
Jesus
and I did
Christ.
That. No. Why don't you fucking whine some more? You want some fucking cheese to go with that? No, it doesn't take talent. And I'm not going to get in a ring with you and do anything about it. You know, if you're going to tell me to get in a ring with you to have a hardcore match, why would I want to have a hardcore match?
I personally won't, but I'll send Vito Andretti your way.
Yeah, I won't. I'm not going to have a hardcore match with somebody when it doesn't. Put me in a ring with somebody that has some fucking talent. I don't want to be in the ring with somebody that has no fucking talent and just wants to swing bats at me. I'm going to fucking run away from it. I'm
because
not gonna let somebody
that's
hit
the
me
logical
with,
thing to do.
I'm going to let somebody hit me with a fucking baseball bat.
Filled with thumbtacks?
Filled with thumbtacks or fucking barbed wire? This is fucking stupid. You know, I'm sorry. You can have a hardcore match every now and then.
Every now and then.
Even, you know, Jerry Lawler and all of them would put barbed wire as the ring ropes. Every now and then. But they didn't do it all the time. It was like once every 6 months.
And it's got to be for a purpose.
And it had a build to it, and it had to be for a purpose, and... You know, they didn't have it every fucking week, and they didn't have it, you know, they didn't have to outdo it every time. They didn't have to, one night you have a flaming table match, and then the next night you have a flaming table match with hypodermic needles on the bottom of it. And then the next night you have a flaming table match with hypodermic needles and cut glass and thumbtacks on the bottom of that.
With KY lube on a pole.
Yeah, with KY lube and Viagra on a pole. You know, you don't have to constantly outdo it. We're rambling on this shit. I mean, if you have any sense and you're a promoter in this business, you already know this shit. We shouldn't have to, we don't have to tell you this. But there's people out there that are trying to run promotions that are ruining wrestling in towns all across this country that don't understand these simple fucking concepts at all. You just wanted to grow up one day to be a wrestler. I wanted to be a wrestler. No, you're not a fucking wrestler. You're ruining the business. Get the fuck out.
I have no talent, so I'm just going to go through these here thumbtacks 17 times.
Fucking dumb. We've got about 7 minutes left here. I want to make a couple plugs before we go off the air here.
Okay, because I wanted to do that too. Go ahead.
We do have a couple more shows this week that are debuting. On Friday, we've got I will be back for another show that I'm doing with Kurt Chaos. You also know him as Cousin Kurt, and we are doing a show called Another Useless Radio Show. That's right.
Kind of like this one, probably.
Well, at least here we kind of cover all kinds of different topics. We don't even talk about topics on that show. We just talk about whatever the fuck we want to. Half the time we sit here and we just talk back and forth about bullshit. And like, oh, that guy said this. And oh, God, that guy said that. We just kind of talk. We play music. We have fun. We drink. It's a good old merry fucking time. So join in on Fridays from 9 to 11 Eastern. And then on Saturday, Kurt also runs a music show where he plays all kinds of different music, ranging from hard rock, heavy metal, to 80s hair bands, to a little bit of newer age, pop, rock.
Any Nickelback?
R&B. I don't think he plays Nickelback.
Look at this photograph!
I don't think he plays any of that shit, but so tune in to him on Saturday for the Late Night Music Lounge. That is from 9 to 11 or 9 to 12, kind of whenever he decides that he's done there, and then we will be back next Wednesday, but returning next Tuesday we'll be shooting the ropes with Cue Ball from 9 to 11 p.m. Eastern right here on Amped Radio. Sorry, I guess nobody decided they wanted to call in today. You're all too busy to
bummer.
Yeah.
I wanted to debate with somebody besides you.
Well, they're all I guess everybody's too busy being busy, I guess.
Quit watching the porn and turned on Amped TV radio.
Quit whacking your PUD and turning on Amped radio. You can also check out our website. It's www.amped-tv.com. You can also reach me. My email address is robdicken@outlook.com. You can reach me on Facebook. All that stuff is actually on the website. If you go to the website to cast and crew, contact information is there. It's also there for Brandon, so you can check out his stuff too, with a little bit of bios and stuff like that. This will be on podcast on both YouTube and the website and on iTunes. So,
whoa, are we going to get paid for this, or is it free iTunes?
That is it. iTunes podcast and stuff. All that's free for everybody to listen to.
Oh, boo!
But I mean, we get ad revenue and shit.
Oh, okay. Yeah, well, so I'm still in.
The more people that watch it actually on YouTube, or go to our website and click on some of our ads and stuff. I just want to here's a plug that I want to make. If you're looking for high quality, low cost car insurance, I would suggest that you go to our website, click on the 21st Century Insurance ad. You'll see that either on the top, bottom, or right hand side of the page. You might have to refresh a few times because it is a rotating ad. But if you click on that, that'll help support the show. Get yourself a free quote, purchase it. You may save yourself up to $522 on auto insurance.
Awesome.
So check that out. And then also on the website, we now have not necessarily a shop, but you can purchase Amped Radio t-shirts.
Sick.
As well as hoodies and cutoff t-shirts. Right now we do this through teespring.com. We have a limit, actually it's a goal, it's not a limit, of 50 shirts. Only 5 are needed right now to print. You can pick up a yellow printed t-shirt for Amped Radio if you didn't know our colors are yellow.
It actually looks really good.
You can pick it up, only $18. So that's not that expensive. You can
good deal.
You can pick up a actual hoodie. It is let's see the color of the hoodie here. I believe it's yellow also. It'll pop up here. It's a yellow hoodie. It's also screen printed. It's actually pretty damn cool looking as well.
That's
only
good.
$35. That's not that bad for a brand new spanking hoodie.
No, it is not.
So you got that. There's also ladies tees on there. It's only $18 for a ladies t-shirt. It is pink, and it's got the Amp logo on it. And then you can also pick up a tank top. If it'll load here, there's the...
Nice.
Pink tee. And then you can pick up a tank top, which is a gray color with a screen print on it. So you've got a few choices there. Check that out on the website. You can check us out on Facebook. Facebook, it is Amped Radio. And on Twitter is Amped TV Radio. And on YouTube, you can check out all of the videos that we have, all the past bowling alleys that we did here on Amped TV and Radio. And you can check out this show as well as all the other shows that are currently going on. The username for YouTube, if I can bring it up here, I'm going to go back to my channel here. I believe it is The Amped Radio. That is T-H-E Amped Radio, all one word. So you can check us out on there as well.
Nice.
Good to go. Brandon, is there anything you want to plug?
My turn?
Yes, it's your turn. Sorry.
Yeah, you were a little long-winded there, buddy.
Sorry.
I returned to the ring on, what is the date? Sunday, November the 23rd at 5 p.m. at the Salem Fairgrounds for the IWXWPCW benefit show for a sheriff deputy up there who is going through some terrible times in his life.
You're a little long-winded there, buddy.
And I will be, what was that in my ear?
I think that that was the,
nice.
The whatever. It was us. It was just that the player loaded and didn't turn off, so I turned it off. Sorry.
Nice. Well, anyway, I'm going to be up at the Salem County Fairgrounds Sunday night, November 23rd at 5 p.m. is the bell time. Sheriff Deputy Benefit Show, come on up and support. And as well, I would like to plug something. If you need a home security system, check out Night and Day Security. You can contact me with any questions that you might have. It's, once again, Night and Day Security. Protect what you love anytime, night or day.
All right. I think that's about it, folks. We are going to call it a night. We will be back next week from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern. Be sure to listen in. And if you didn't get to listen in to us today, hope you're listening in at YouTube or on podcast, on iTunes, or on the website. I want to bid everybody adieu, and with that, I think we'll just go ahead and head out. Brandon, you got anything else to add, buddy?
We're elite, and we're better than you.
That's right, baby.